If you have your Bibles, turn to Philippians 3, verses 12, 13, and 14. One of my favorite writings of the Apostle Paul. Talk about this morning, pressing on towards the goal that Paul talks about. In 2011, going to higher ground with God, continuing our theme of growth in this new year. But as always, before we talk about the Son, let's bow our heads and hearts and talk to His Father first. Father, I thank You for the opportunity to make choices and to grow. Although I don't always choose the right choice that would please You, there's a cross that I can go to the foot of and be forgiven. And if there are three steps forward and two back the next day, that's still progress, and You still love us and don't give up on us and are there for us. And I thank You for this whole process of the Christian life, and that You've promised that one day we're going to make it. What You start in us, You will finish. And someday we're going to be like You. And in the meantime, keep us moving on and growing and going up to higher ground. I thank You for the Apostle Paul. I thank You for his challenges that he places in our life. And that's my prayer this morning, as we come before his teaching, that You would just lay us bare. And whatever we need in our heart and in our mind to change and become more like Jesus, you'll do that on us before we leave in these next few moments. Father, You know each and every person in this place. You know the joys and the victories, and You know the trials, the failures, the broken hearts. Come work on us. Take the wounded warriors, and by Your Spirit, heal us and bind us up and get us ready to go back and to serve for another week. We love You and are grateful that You love us and care for us. As we open Your Word this morning, Father, we pray for the one who teaches, that You would forgive him his sins, for they are many. We come to this place this morning to see Jesus of Nazareth and Him only. And it's in His name that we pray. Amen. I love these verses. Starting at verse 12, Paul says, "Now that I have already, not that I have already obtained this or have already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Jesus Christ took hold of me. Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus." Now, in just a minute, we're going to be talking about moving on up this year to higher ground with God. But before we do that, there is one sore thumb that sticks out of the text that we need to cover on the front end. So let's do that quickly. Sore thumb number one and only this morning. I want you to please note the single-mindedness of the Apostle Paul. Paul says in verse 13b, "I am a jack of all trades." Doesn't say that, does it? He says, "My interests are many and varied." Doesn't say that. He says, "Many things I do." No, he says, "One thing." "One thing I do." This is one place where Satan subtly attacks the body of Christ. Paul says that we are to be parts of a body, making up a total body. Kobe Bryant's the superstar of the Los Angeles Lakers. But if each player on the Lakers tried to play his position, the team would self-destruct. You know, many of our church problems, I believe, could be avoided simply by all of us learning to play our appropriate positions. And Ecclesiastes says, "Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all of your mind." And often our conflicts result when we dabble in somebody else's area that we're not gifted in. Paul emphasizes the importance of single-mindedness. Too often we like to play that role of fixer as Christians, don't we? Let me tell you something. We're not called to do something about everything. Say it again. We're not called to do something about everything. Kierkegaard said, singleness of mind is to will one thing. You see, when we lose our single-mindedness, we dissipate the power of the body of Christ. And if the people of God ever truly understand the power of single-mindedness, we're going to blow Satan away. I guess it's every pastor's dream to someday be able to devote all of your time to your strength, to your gift, to the part of ministry that you enjoy the most, and mine is teaching this book. I love teaching the Bible. I found this little paragraph in my illustration file. There was no author given. It's called, "What a Job." Let me read it to you. "What a job. The pastor teaches, though he must solicit his own classes. He heals, though without pills or medicine. He is sometimes a lawyer, often a social worker, something of an editor, a bit of a philosopher and entertainer, a salesman, a decorative piece for public functions, and he is supposed to be a scholar. He visits the sick, marries people, buries people, labors to console those in sorrow and to admonish those who sin, and tries to say sweet when criticized for doing his job. He plans programs, appoints committees when he can get them, spends considerable time in keeping people out of each other's hair. Between times, he prepares a sermon and preaches it on Sunday to those who don't happen to have any other engagements. Then on Sunday, or Monday, he smiles when some jovial chap smacks him on the back and roars, 'What a job,' one day a week." Folks, every one of us has been given a gift. Every one of us has been given a gift by the Father with which we are to edify and to build up the body of Christ. Take that gift, identify your gift in your life, and develop singleness of mind, and like Ecclesiastes says, do it with all of your might. I promise you God will honor that gift and enable it with his power when you identify it and commit to using it with singleness of mind. I believe you can have almost anything you want if you're truly committed to singleness of mind. And it's not just spiritual, it's not just biblical, it's universal. You can apply it to almost anything. If you want to be a millionaire and you start early enough and work hard enough, you can be a millionaire. If you want to get to the top of your profession and you work hard enough, you can get to the top of your profession. If you want to be the best Bible teacher or Sunday school teacher or Christian witness or soul winner for Christ, there is tremendous power in singleness of mind. Beloved, as the Church of Jesus Christ, we need to be single-minded in our pursuit of holiness and righteousness. We need to be single-minded in the elimination of sin from our lives. We need to be single-minded in our pursuit to know God and to draw closer to Him. We need to be single-minded in our relationship with Jesus Christ and sharing the good news of the gospel with every person that we meet. I saw in Leadership Magazine an article that said, in 1992, a Los Angeles County parking control officer came upon a brown Cadillac Eldorado illegally parked next to the curb on street sweeping day. The officer dutifully wrote out a ticket, ignoring the man seated in the driver's seat behind the wheel. The officer reached inside the open window and placed the $30 citation on the dashboard. The driver of that car made no excuses, gave no argument, and with good reason. The driver of the car had been shot in the head 10 to 12 hours before. He was sitting up, stiff as a board, slumped slightly forward with blood on his face. He was dead. The officer, preoccupied with ticket writing, was unaware of anything out of the ordinary. He got back into his squad car and drove away. Beloved, every day we walk by people who are dead in their transgressions. They're dead in their sin, and we go right by them. And if we do notice them, what gets our attention is their offenses to us when it ought to be their need. Folks, those dead people, they don't need our judgment. They need our Savior. Lev and I, not too many weeks ago, were in a restaurant one evening, and there were two uppity young ladies sitting behind us. there was an elderly lady there who was a waitress, and she came in, and she began cleaning the tables, cleaning up. She began to witness very loudly to these two young girls. It was the neatest thing. We sat there and heard her talk about the blood of Jesus. She talked about the power of the cross and the power of the Holy Spirit. I nudged Love and I said, man, that's what we all in the church ought to be doing. And those two ladies left with their arrogant noses bent out of shape. I told Love, man, she could lose her job mixing business and religion like that, but she didn't care. She really didn't give a rip. Because you see, she had singleness of mind. Like Paul is talking about here in verse 13. But one thing I do, and she had found the one thing that she had been called to do, to take the Savior to the sinner. And she was doing it with all of her might, as Ecclesiastes says. Singleness of heart, singleness of mind is to will one thing. All right, that appetizer out of the way, on to the main course for this morning, moving on up to higher ground. The Apostle Paul often uses athletic illustrations in his teaching, in his letters. And this morning's text is one of those illustrations. He did it because, just like today, the people of the first century could relate to the world of competition. They could relate to the training and performing, pushing to the limit, persevering. And so the Apostle Paul talks about pressing on towards a goal, towards a finish line, running a race that involves a starting point, a race that involves training and discipline, a race that involves competing against the enemy, and a race that involves a final destination. And as we Christians press on towards the finish line, toward the final destination with Christ, we're involved every day in a contest against our enemy, Satan. But in order to run the race of the Christian life wisely against the enemy, and in a way that we won't tire out too quickly or give up before we reach the finish line, there are certain key elements that we need to be aware of and to understand. Our race is a constant climb to higher ground with God. And in this text, Paul gives us five things about that race that will help us to press on toward the goal. For those keeping score, 5 points, we're going to move quickly. Here we go. First of all, the Apostle Paul would have us note a progressive plan. A progressive plan, verse 12. Not that I have already obtained all this, Paul says, in other words, I'm still in the race myself, or have already been made perfect. I haven't reached the finish line, Paul says. But I press on, I keep on keeping on to take hold of that which Christ Jesus took hold of me. I will be eternally grateful to my friend Steve Brown for all that he has done for me. From the teaching that he gave me and still gives me back when I became a Christian for the first time. The encouragement. I thought this week in preparing this message of a principle that he taught me very early in my Christian walk and in my ministry. And the principle is that the Christian life, folks, is a process. It's a process. It's a road that we are on. It's a journey that we are on. And we're all at different points on that road. We don't make fun of anybody else. Because if you're like me, you went the wrong way on that road for quite some time. I did for 33 years. And it was Steve's teaching that turned me around and got me headed in the right direction. This week, I went through the stages of the process that I had gone through since the beginning. And the first one was, how in the world can I possibly be forgiven? And then when I realized that I truly was forgiven, how in the world can God's grace be this radical and this true? And then when I began to have success, I kept waiting for the other shoe to fall. I kept waiting for it to fall apart. Steve would say to me, Bill, do you ever think that God just likes you? I said, no, it's never crossed my mind. But I want you to know today, I know that he loves me more than I'll ever know. I know that he'll never let me go, and I'm really his. I pray for Steve and his ministry every morning because he's the one who made Jesus real to me. He's the one who took him out of the hymn books and the stained glass windows and introduced me to Jesus for the very first time. Let me tell you something, folks. The Christian life is a process. And as we talked about 2 weeks ago, sometimes it is 3 steps forward and the next day 2 steps back. That's still 1 step of progress in that process. Satan wants you to believe the old black and white rule. If you've broke one of your New Year's resolution, you might as well throw in the towel and walk away, because God doesn't want you. It's a lie from the pit of hell. Brothers and sisters, be assured that our walk with Jesus is a process. And even though we reach plateaus, even though we take steps backward, it is still a consistent walk to higher ground with God. I remember when Levi and Stevie went whitewater rafting through the Grand Canyon on the Colorado River. We got there early in the morning and we met the guide, and he had a short school with us before we took off. This instructor said, when you fall into the water, when you find yourself floating down the river, when the boat flips over, and I nudged Love and I said, notice he's not saying if, he's saying when. Jesus gave us the very same warning. Jesus didn't say, in this world you may encounter some difficulties. Jesus didn't say, in this world there are a few who will have problems. Jesus didn't say if, he said when. Jesus said, in this world you will have trouble, tribulation, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome this world, and so can you. During the filming of Ben-Hur, Charlton Heston had trouble learning to drive a chariot. I mean, who wouldn't? And with much patience, he was finally able to control the vehicle. But he still had some doubts. And so he went to Cecil B. DeMille, who was the director. And he said, I think I can drive the chariot, but I'm not sure that I can win the race. And DeMille responded, you just stay in the race. As director, I'll make you win. Beloved, no matter where you're at right now in the process of the Christian life, Jesus of Nazareth makes you that same promise. Jesus says, believer, you just stay in the race. I'll make sure that you win because of the cross. You hang in there, and I'll make sure you get home before the dark. You see, the measure of progress is not whether or not you have a tough problem to deal with. The measure of progress is whether or not you're dealing with the same problem that you had last year. Say it again. The measure of progress is not whether or not you have a tough problem to deal with. The measure of progress is whether or not you're dealing with the same problem you had this time last year. The Christian life is a process, and Jesus will help you with every single step. And then secondly, I want you to see not only a progressive plan, I want you to note a forgiven past, verse 13b. Forgetting what is behind. I like that. Forgetting what is behind. The decision had been made. The troops had been deployed. The battleships were on their way. Nearly 3 million soldiers were preparing to slam against Hitler's Atlantic Wall in France. D-Day was already set in motion. Responsibility for the invasion fell squarely on the four-star shoulders of General Dwight D. Eisenhower. The general had spent the last night before the attack with the men of the 101st Airborne. They called themselves the Screaming Eagles. As he prepared his men, they took their places and they checked their equipment. Ike went from soldier to soldier offering words of encouragement. Many of those young flyers were young enough to be his sons, and he treated them like they were his sons. A correspondent wrote that as Eisenhower watched the C-47s take off and disappear into the darkness, his hands were sunk deeply into his pockets and tears filled his eyes because he knew what was ahead for them. The general then went into his quarters and he sat down at his desk and he took a pen and paper and he wrote a message which would be delivered to the White House in the event of a defeat. It was as brief as it was courageous. He said, our landings have failed. The troops, the air, the Navy did all that bravery and devotion to duty could possibly do. If any blame or fault attaches itself to this attempt, it is mine and mine alone. You know, it could be argued that the greatest act of courage that day was not in a cockpit or a foxhole, but at a desk where the one at the top took responsibility for the ones below. When the one in charge took the blame, even before the blame needed taken. You see, folks, before our war with Satan began, God forgave. Before a mistake could be made, forgiveness was already offered. Before one finger of blame could be pointed, grace was provided. The one at the top took responsibility for the ones at the bottom. The one at the top of the cross took responsibility for those gathered at the bottom with the hammer and the nails. Can you believe that? Would you have had that attitude? Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing to me. That wouldn't have been my attitude. I would have said, Father, get those suckers. Rear back and pass a lightning bolt and get me down off this thing. But not Jesus. He said, Father, forgive them. I want to read you some scriptures and I want you to listen carefully. Jeremiah 31, 34. For I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. Jeremiah 38, 8. I will cleanse them from all the sin they have committed against me and will forgive all their sins of rebellion against me. Psalm 103, verse 12. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. Micah 7, 14. You will again have compassion on us. You will tread our sins underfoot and hurl our iniquities into the depths of the sea. Can you believe that? We have a God that not only forgives, but he forgets. Don't you love that? And when you go before the throne as a believer asking forgiveness for a sin for the second time, God gets a puzzled look on his face and he strokes his beard and he says, Child, what are you talking about? You see, Paul makes a point here when talking about pressing on towards the goal to mention forgiveness. Forgetting what is behind. Why do you think he does that? Let me tell you why. Because Paul had been forgiven a lot. He had a lot to forget. Remember that Paul was persecuting and killing Christians before he was saving them. If you remember, it was Paul who held the clothes of Stephen, the first Christian martyr, who was stoned for calling the Jewish council a bunch of twits responsible for killing the Messiah. Paul had a past. But Paul knew, and he wanted us to know, that with God, your past really is the past. Satan wants you to believe you've got to carry around the garbage of your past forever. That God's going to hold it against you forever. But Paul wants you to know that Jesus' blood washes that past away, and you can press on toward your goal without any guilt. I love that t-shirt that says, the next time Satan reminds you of your past, remind him of his future. There's a Russian fable about a master and a servant who went on a journey to the northlands of Russia. And before they reached their destination, they got caught in a blinding blizzard. They lost direction. They got lost in the night. The next morning, a search party found the master frozen to death face down in the snow. But when they lifted up the body of the master, underneath they found the servant cold but alive. And he told how his master had voluntarily covered him up and saved his life. You see, a Christian story is very much the same. The master voluntarily climbed onto a cross and covered your sins and saved your life. I don't know about you, but I find great comfort in the fact that God has forgiven my past and is active in forgiving me when I blow it in the present and will forgive me tomorrow in the future. How about you? Some of you are out there carrying around a lot of excess baggage from the past, thinking you can never be forgiven. Let me tell you what Steve Brown said to me when I was in your shoes. That's arrogance. That's arrogance. To think that the blood of Jesus could save all of mankind from their sins, but it wasn't good enough for you. Your sins have been forgiven. They've been taken away from you as far as the east is from the west. They've been buried in the deepest sea, and God has put a no fishing sign right above them. Thirdly, I want you to see not only a progressive plan and a forgiven past, I want you to know the future hope, verse 14. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which that which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. Now that we've talked about forgiving the past and the forgetfulness of God when it comes to forgiving sin, let me ask you some questions. Have you left the past? And I mean fully left it and moved on beyond it. Are you making progress? Some kind of deliberate progress with your life? Are you passionately pursuing a dream, a specific goal? The singleness of mind that we talked about earlier comes into play here. Are you pursuing something with all of your might? Robert Ballard was a man with a quest. He wanted to find the Titanic. On September the 1st, 1985, he discovered the sunken ship in the North Atlantic, more than 350 miles off the coast of Newfoundland. You kind of get chills when you read the description of the first time that he sent down that bright probe light and saw that sight more than 2 miles below the surface of those frigid waters. This is what he wrote. My first direct view of Titanic lasted less than 2 minutes. But the stark sight of her immense black hull towering over the ocean floor will remain ingrained in my memory forever. My lifelong dream was to find this great ship, and during the past 13 years, the quest for her has dominated my entire life. Do you have a goal that you're pressing on towards that dominates your entire life? Is it a heavenly goal? A spiritual goal? Is it something that would accomplish your purpose on being here on earth as a Christian to praise and glorify and bring honor to the God of the universe? What's your quest in life? For what are you reaching out for in this race to accomplish? What are you leaning forward to take hold of, as the Apostle Paul says? What consumed you, Christian? To what are you committed to accomplishing? Meaningless garbage that 10 years from now won't amount to a hill of beans? Beloved, for God's sake, set a goal. Get a passion. Take interest in your future. Consume yourself with something for which God will someday say to you, well done, good and faithful servant. Well done. Don't let 2011 pass you by. I feel someday when we stand before the throne of God, God's going to come up to us and say, I want to show you some clips from your life, Bill. And he's going to say, this first clip is of the things that you thought were important. And then I'm going to show you a clip of those things that I consider important, Bill. The lost, the hungry, the thirsty, the poor, the lonely, those in prison, the elderly. And you know what my nightmare is? My nightmare is that those two clips, his and mine, are not going to look anything alike. And I see for the first time what I could have been. I see what I could have done for him. If I just put my ego and selfish pride on the shelf and been a servant with a goal and a passion to achieve that goal. I think we need to mention our ultimate goal, the heavenward that Paul talks about here. 2 Corinthians 2:9 says, eyes not seen, nor ear heard, nor the mind of man conceived. That which God has prepared for those who love him, that means we can't even fathom what heaven will be like. Streets of gold, gates of pearl, foundations of precious stones. You know, there's nothing more beautiful than a bride. One of the side benefits of being a pastor is that I get an early glimpse of the bride as she stands back there at that door getting ready to come up the aisle. And I have to say, I've never seen an ugly bride. I've seen some grooms that could use an alteration or two, but never a bride. When you read that our heavenly home is similar to a bride, doesn't it make you want to go there? I mean, the world I woke up to this morning couldn't be described as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband, could yours? I mean, part of the world to which I awoke this morning was filled with abortion and murder and suicide and pornography, and Satan worship, and adultery, and deceit, and hate, and lies, and selfishness, and divorce, and child abuse. I mean, when you look at this world stained by innocent blood, smudged with selfishness, doesn't it make you want to go home just a little? And if one of the joys of the ministry is a bride descending the church aisle, then one of the griefs is a body encased in a coffin at the front of the church. It's never easy to say goodbye. It's never easy to walk away. The hardest task in the world is to place a final kiss on cold lips that will not kiss back. The hardest thing in the world is to say goodbye. But you know what? You know what John says in his revelation? He says that in the next world, we will never mention the words goodbye. They'll never be spoken. Tell me, doesn't that look you want to go there just a little? I mean, when things got bad in this world, there were tears. There won't be in the next. I had people to comfort me in my life. My mom and my dad took away my tears and my fears. And my wife supports me and takes away my fears. But John's revelation tells us, get this, someday, God himself will wipe away your tears. Isn't that awesome? The same hands that formed the universe will touch my face and dry my tears. The same hands that etched the Ten Commandments will caress my face. The same hands that were pinned to a Roman cross will someday cut my face and turn my crying into laughter. Will it be worth it? Yeah, it really will. Because he's never lied to us. And eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor the mind of man conceived that which God has prepared for those who love him. Fourthly, I want you to see not only a progressive plan, a forgiven past, and a future hope. I want you to note a determined attitude. Verse 15. All of us who are mature should take such a view, such an attitude of things. And if on some point you think differently, that too God will make clear to you. Paul's saying the Christian life is a process. And God makes it easier by taking away our sin and our guilt. And the future hope of heaven makes it even more exciting. But at best, it's tough. At best, it gets very difficult at times. At best, it's going to take a determined attitude in order to make it through. And at least it means picking up a cross and laying down your life. And then I love the way Paul graciously allows others the freedom to grow at their own pace. He says, and if at some point you think differently, that's okay. That too God will make clear to you. But as far as Paul was concerned, hanging tough and maintaining a determined attitude are a part of living for Christ. If it didn't cost you anything, it's not worth anything. If it didn't cost you a focused life, if it didn't cost you a determined attitude, if it didn't cost you everything that you are, it's not worth anything. The initial gift, as we talked about before, is free. After that, it costs everything. Mario Cuomo was the governor of the state of New York, and now his son is the governor of the state of New York. And Mario tells about a time when he got very discouraged during a political campaign and he wanted to walk away and quit. He was devastated. And he went back to his hotel room and he sat down and he thought, what would my dad have done? And he remembered a time when they as a family moved to Hollywood, New York, from apartments that they lived in all their lives into their very first home. They had a little piece of ground. There were trees all around. It was a beautiful place. And there was one big, beautiful blue spruce tree, 40 feet tall, that stood in the front yard. The first week that they moved in there, a terrible storm came. And they came home and they found that spruce tree uprooted, lying part in the front yard and part in the street. Their dad, who was an Italian immigrant, was 5'6" and 155 pounds. And he looked and he found his boys and he rounded them up and he said, boys, we're going to push them up again. And they said, Papa, you're crazy. Those roots are out of the ground. He said, shut up. We're going to push them up and he's going to grow again. They got the rope. They tied it to the top of the tree and the boys got behind and they pulled on that rope and he got on the front side and he pushed on the trunk of that tree. And very much to everyone's surprise, they stood that tree up. And then their Papa got down on his hands and knees, and he dug with his hands in a pouring down rainstorm for 2 hours, and he'd take away the dirt until this root would get a little lower and a little lower, and then he'd go to the next root, 2 hours until all the roots were covered with dirt again. And he said, boys, she's gonna grow, don't you worry. Today, 40 years later, that tree is 65 feet tall and is growing again. And Mario Cuomo said, I remembered that night in Hollywood, and I remember the determination of my father, and I went back to my campaign, and I won. I want you to remember, not 40 years ago in Hollywood, New York, I want you to remember 2,000 years ago in a city called Jerusalem, where a man climbed onto a cross with determination, I would have gotten off. And he was killed on that cross and taken down and put into a tomb, but he didn't stay there. On the third day, he got up out of his grave and he walked out inviting you to do the same. It takes perseverance. It takes determined attitude. It takes hanging tough and not giving up, because the truth, he's all there is, folks. He's all there is. Jesus is all there is, and serving him is really all you've got. And if you believe differently, you're fooling yourself. You're playing your own clip of what's important to you. It's hard to keep our focus on the goal without a determined attitude. No matter what comes my way, it's the attitude we ought to have. No matter what comes my way, I'm going to knock it down. I'm going to get over it. I'm going to get through it. But I am not going to give up no matter what. Do you ever get discouraged? Do you ever think, my life has been a series of failures? How could I ever have a great focus or be consumed with a quest? Jesus would tell you, focus on me, have a determined attitude, do the best that you can, and he'll do the rest. Abraham Lincoln said this, I do the very best I know how, the very best I can, and I mean to keep doing so. And Abraham Lincoln's life is the best example of his own words. I want you to consider the chronology of his career. Listen to this. 1831, Abraham Lincoln failed in business. 1832, defeated for the legislature. 1833, again failed in business. 1834, elected to the legislature. 1835, lifelong sweetheart dies. 1836, had a nervous breakdown. 1838, defeated for speaker. 1840, defeated for elector. 1843, defeated for Congress. 1846, elected to Congress. 1848, defeated for Congress. 1855, defeated for the Senate. 1856, defeated for Vice President. 1858, defeated for the Senate. 1860, elected President of the United States. Anybody can give up. Anybody. Don't be one of them. Don't let Satan pull you away because you may be right on the verge of your presidency. Right on the verge of your destiny. If I have one redeeming quality as a pastor, it's not my education. I never been to Bible college. It's not my worldly background or life experiences or business career, salesmanship, or love for God. It is that I will not give up. Fifthly and finally, very quickly, I want you to know not only a progressive plan, a forgiven past, a future hope, and a determined attitude, but I want you to know at a higher standard, verse 16. Only let us live up to what we have already attained. Paul is saying, let us live up to a higher standard, which is truth. Let us keep striving for perfection, even though we're not going to make it in this lifetime. That's what grace is all about. But we are going to make it someday. It does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him. A TV news camera crew was on assignment years ago in southern Florida during the widespread destruction of Hurricane Andrew. In one scene, one subdivision, they were filming the devastation and the debris. It wiped out entire subdivisions. And this was the case in the one that they were in, except there was one house still on its foundation, didn't have much damage, a few shingles were off the roof. The owner was cleaning up the yard and a reporter went over and approached him. And the reporter said, sir, why is your house the only one still standing in this entire neighborhood? How did you manage to escape the severe damage of the hurricane? And this is what he said. He said, I built this house myself. And I also built it according to the Florida State Building Code. When the code called for 2x6 roof trusses, I put in 2x6 roof trusses. When the code called for three times as many nails as they normally put in, I paid the extra price and I put in all of those nails. I was told that a house built according to code could withstand a hurricane. I did, and it did. I suppose no one else in my neighborhood followed those rules. You know, when the sun is shining and the skies are blue, building our lives on something other than the guidelines of God's word can be tempting. But there's a hurricane coming for every one of us. And if you want to make it through the hurricane, there's a simple rule to follow. Be obedient to a higher standard, God's word. Be obedient to the truth and not the lies and the deception of this world. Build your life according to the building codes that you will find in this book, and you'll be able to weather every storm that comes along. And let me tell you something else. Fellowship is an important part of being obedient to a higher standard. You see, standing alone by myself, I'm going to get knocked down in a storm. But standing together with you guys, my brothers and sisters in Christ who love me, with our arms locked together, we can stand strong through any storm. And we can kick Satan where he needs to be kicked. Galatians 6:9. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. 1 Corinthians 15:58. Therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Paul says, Bill's paraphrase, keep on keeping on. Enter the race and you fix your eyes on Jesus and don't you take them off. You keep on making progress in the process, no matter how hard it gets. You forget about your past because God has forgiven and forgotten your past. Be consumed with a goal. Never forget your future. Never forget your destination. Acquire a determined attitude. And don't dare give up. Don't you walk away no matter what. And remember, you've been called to a higher standard. And your brothers and sisters are going to help you to stand and to stand strong. Don't you give up. You may be on the verge of your destiny. You may be on the verge of your presidency. Don't you dare give up. Let me finish with this. In Jesus' name we pray.